genre.
Welcome back to Rocky Minute, the daily podcast where we cover the movie Rocky 1 minute at a time. I'm Doug Greenberg.
And I'm Jason Hayes.
And with us this week is Philly Rocky Film Tour guide, Mike Kunda. Hey, Mike, how you doing?
I'm doing very well. You guys are going to keep me in suspense here with this podcast. I'm so excited. I've never done minute podcast before, so if you leave it up to me, I'll drag it out to an hour, I promise.
Okay. Well, you're not the only one. We've never done a podcast before, so we're brand new to this, too.
Well, you guys are doing well, because I've listened to some of the first ones you started doing on Rocky, and I love it. You guys got a good play on the sound here. I love it.
Great. Thanks, man.
Thank you.
So, Mike, in addition to doing the Philly Rocky film tour, also co-host of the Slycast, which you guys cover all of Sylvester Stallone's movies, correct?
That is correct. Those guys are insane maniacs, and they keep me on my toes. They're good guys. I love them.
And you have the distinct pleasure of running through some of the greatest 80s action films of all time.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. I mean, a child from those guys are a lot younger than me, so they have a certain input that's very interesting in mine, and we have a lot of fun.
That's excellent. It's a great podcast. I suggest everybody go check it out. So today we're knocking out minute 31, which begins with an angry Mr. Juergens, and it ends with a happy Mr. Juergens. So Juergens continues from last week that he has promoted fights in every goddamn country in this world. And he's broken his ass over this one, but he's out of ideas. What's Apollo's reaction to this, Jay?
Well, Apollo, you know, very smart guy, he's a businessman. He comes up with a great idea of, you know, if you can't get a top contender, which they've exhausted all of those possibilities, then we got to get a novelty, which I agree with. There's nothing people in America like more than a novelty.
This is the idea minute.
This is it. This is where the whole movie comes together. The whole plan, everything comes together right here. This is in the moment right now where we know what's going to happen. Rocky's going to get his chance, and that's what's, you know, going down here. But a novelty is, I agree, because we just recently saw this year, we had the Conor McGregor Mayweather fight, and mm-hmm. you had the Triple G and Canelo Alvarez fight, and the Conor McGregor fight and Conor McGregor and Floyd Mayweather fight like stole the show this year. And that was basically a novelty. It was, you know, something that's never been done before, something unusual, something. And America ate that shit up. They loved it.
That's very true. They did it that.
So Apollo, before the light bulb goes off over his head, he has a few seconds of contemplation where he doesn't want to hear what Juergens is saying. And did you get a look at Duke's face, his trainer? What do you think? What is Duke saying on his face there, Mike?
You know, Duke has been in with Apollo. So I think he's learned to eventually go with Apollo on this. But even this is surprising Apollo or surprising Duke. And I met Tony Burton and I spent some time with him. And the thing that a lot of people don't know about Tony Burton is that he was a major stoner. He loved his weed more than anyone. I'm telling you. That's another story for another time. So it wouldn't surprise me if he took a few puffs before this scene with Carl Weathers. Not that Carl Weathers did anything, but that's my little take on Duke.
Yeah, Duke. He we'll get to it later on in the minute. But at first, after Juergens says he's out of ideas, he doesn't know what the hell to do, Duke just, he crosses his arms and gives Juergens the filthiest look, like he is not having any of Juergens' shit.
Very true.
But Apollo, you know, after a few seconds of contemplation, you know, he comes to it. The revelation minute.
Well, I think one of the things that Juergens has a problem with is that he doesn't know his own name. This is something that's been gone back and forth in Rocky mythology. Was there a mistake in the movie? Did Stallone screw up writing the name? I don't know if you guys noticed this. I didn't hear the minute before this or when Mickey tells Rocky there's some guy from Miles Juergens' office looking for you. Well, he's referred to as George Juergens and Miles Juergens, Miles Juergens production. So the only thing I think that makes any sense, maybe it's some type of nickname that people in the boxing world or in that boxing world would call Miles Juergens, and maybe Juergens is maybe he's going back and forth with an identity crisis between George and Miles. Did you guys pick that up when you watched Rocky?
No, I didn't. Did you, Jay? No.
Yeah, they call him different names, and he's listed in the credits as Juergens, but it's you know, Mickey said. Rocky's standing in the gym, and of course, Mickey's like, yeah, there's some guy from Miles Juergens wants to see you. It put me on. Yeah. You're kidding. Yeah, they were here about an hour ago. Yeah, what they want? I told you before, you dumb Dago. Over 6 years, I've been coming here. You've been putting me. So anyways, that's one of my favorite scenes. But I always wonder if other people catch these little things that are in the Rocky universe. So apparently you didn't, and we'll just move on.
Yeah, I knew Miles. I didn't know that he was also referred to as George.
Oh, yeah.
Where does that happen?
So when he meets, of course, when him and Apollo were talking, I think someone calls him George. And then when he meets Rocky, when Rocky comes through the door, he obviously, he says, George Juergens. And then he says, have a seat, Rocky. So, and then Mickey, and then Mickey, of course, calls him Miles Juergens. So, yeah. So, anyways, just one of those little things. It's like the shotgun or the hunting rifle in Rocky's apartment that, you know, we see later when he brings Adrian there for the first time.
Right. Interesting.
I didn't notice that. I'll be looking out for the shotgun soon. When do we get to that? It's coming up.
Oh. Yes.
Yeah, coming up in like a couple of weeks.
Oh, that's right.
I'll be on the edge of my seat.
That's right. That's when Rocky kind of beds Adrian. Oh, spoiler alert. Spoiler alert. My God. What am I doing?
All right. So Apollo launches into his monologue about the novelty idea.
Yeah.
He calls America the land of opportunity. True. So he's going to give a local underdog fighter an opportunity. A Snow White underdog. He is really driving home this point that it has to be a white fighter. Why is that?
Well, I mean, that's what happened with Muhammad Ali and Chuck Wepner. You guys know the story about Chuck Wepner and how it relates to Rocky?
Yeah, but we didn't know the background to that fight.
All right, so very quickly, Chuck was ranked 8th in the top 10. And he wasn't a particularly phenomenal fighter. And it was in between Frazier 1 and Frazier 2 when Ali chose Wepner. But it wasn't Ali's idea. It was Don King's idea. Nobody wanted Ali to get hurt. They wanted him in great shape to fight Frazier for Frazier 2. But the problem was he was now champion. He beats Foreman, and Ali is now champion, and he's got to keep up his title defenses. So they wanted him to pick someone who's going to be very easy to beat, but yet in the top 10. So there was a bunch of black guys in the top 10, and Don King says, let's go with the white guy. Let's give the white guy a chance. That was put on flags and banners. You know, it was always, you know, give the black guy a chance. This was give the white guy a chance. Mm-hmm. And so Chuck Wepner had then drafted a poem to rival Ali's poem about fighting, and it was this whole thing. Anyways, I believe that Stallone was so influenced by the events that took place around the Chuck Wepner Muhammad Ali fight, he transferred some of those, or at least I could say Sly was Chuck Wepner was the catalyst for many of the events that took place in Rocky. So that's why I felt we get a white fighter instead of maybe a higher ranked fighter that wasn't white, maybe was Latino, black, whatever.
So that kind of even supports Wepner's lawsuit, because there's more involving the background of the fight too that Sly took to write?
Yeah, there was a lot. I'm finishing my second book now, which is about Chuck Wepner, and I've become very close friends with Chuck, and I've interviewed him for 2 years and a lot of people around him, and you know, I was familiar with the court documents, and I have to tell you, there comes a point where I think Sly felt backed into a corner and didn't give Chuck enough credit during the lawsuit. And I think Chuck made it appear a little too much in his favor that he was the sole inspiration for Rocky. Because, there was a lot of people that were the inspiration for Rocky. Stallone put several people into like this mental blender, including himself, and out comes Rocky Balboa. So, at the end of the day, the judge suggested to Stallone's camp that they settle out of court, and that's what they did.
That's a real interesting story.
Wow, very interesting.
Yeah, there's a lot. There's so much to it. I mean, I don't want to monopolize all of it on just that topic, but there's a fascinating background between Chuck and Sly and the stories that I've been writing about. It's amazing.
All right. When's that book coming out?
So, you know, Chuck's movie just came out in May, and it was on DVD. Came out on DVD, I think, in August.
Right.
And I'm the last chapter I'm writing right now. It's about the movie and how the world is reacting to the movie, how Stallone reacted to the movie, how it was reviewed, and how it all changed Chuck's life, he and his wife Linda, how their lives have changed. I mean, when you have a major motion picture being done about your life, and you have a big player like Liev Schreiber, mm-hmm. I mean, and Naomi Watts playing Linda Wepner, that's a huge, huge deal in a person's life. So I have one publisher right now that's interested in it. They specialize in boxing periodicals and books and whatnot. So I'm hoping once I hand this over to them, someone will have take pity on me and say, "Oh, let's give this fool a shot." I hope.
Well, good luck, man.
Thank you. But anyways, that's where a lot of this comes from. You know, Sly had been very gracious for years, acknowledging Chuck's inspiration or being the catalyst to inspire Stallone to write Rocky. Rocky was going to come out in some form. He was going to come out as a cab driver in Philadelphia who runs for mayor and cleans up the town with a Rocky-esque point of view. But after, you know, Stallone wasn't sold on that, and after seeing the Chuck Wepner fight, that's really what changed his mind. He was like, "Oh my God, this is it. This fight, this supposed stumble bum is going the distance with Muhammad Ali. That's my end of the movie. Now I just have to get the character to the fight." And, you know, that then became Rocky. So
he was writing Rocky either way. It was just what form would it take?
Oh, yeah. I mean, Rocky could have come out as a cross-country skier, a runner. He could have come out a swimmer. He was even going to try Rocky as an actor. It maybe wouldn't have been called Rocky, but, the idea, the concept of Rocky. But Stallone had always felt, no one wants to read about a struggling actor. That's not interesting enough. But if he could put his own ideas into the body, the physicality of a fighter like Rocky, okay, now you have something. Now you've got something people could sink their teeth into. And I don't know how you guys feel in general about Rocky, but the one thing that I love to punch people in the mouth verbally with is when they tell me it's a sports movie. Rocky mm-hmm. is not a sports movie. It's a love story. The sports is about 9 minutes of it. That's it.
Right.
Maybe 12 minutes of the movie. You'd be equally to call it a pet shop movie. Boxing, you know what I mean? That's just what they do. It's the story of these two supposed losers who they see themselves as losers, but they come together as one, like, winning team, you know, one person. And that this is why I think Rocky endures for 41 years.
Yeah, and continues.
Oh my God, it continues. It's amazing. You know, I work with tourists on a daily basis, and I mean, all year long, we see thousands of people that come from all over the world just to take these Rocky tours and see all the filming locations. That's insane. It's absolutely insane. And I always tell people, you know, you can't fly the Millennium Falcon. You can't put on Superman's cape and fly, but you can run the Rocky steps. You can go to the streets where Rocky walked with Paulie or Adrian or Butkus and touch that, you know? And I think it's a very visceral experience for a lot of people. Anyways.
Yeah. You mentioned that the fighting part only takes, what'd you say, like 12 minutes?
Nine or 12 minutes. It doesn't take long.
It's still going to take us about 3 weeks to cover it, though.
I know. Hey, the 1 minute podcast. That's the it lives up to its name. You know, that's great.
All right. So Apollo Creed calls himself sentimental, and he believes that the country is going to eat up the fact that he's going to give an underdog a chance. And he insists on it being a local boy, too, local Philly fighter, on the country's biggest birthday. So after Apollo delivers his monologue, he goes, you know, Juergens gets up. Go back to the clip, because Juergens gets up, and then from in between the space in between Juergens and Apollo, you see Duke kind of rise from the ashes with this big smile on his face.
He realized it's a great idea as well.
There it is. You know, he's my brother pointed out that he was pissed when Apollo's pissed. He's happy when Apollo's happy. It's like, you know, like he's looking out for Apollo. Like, he's more than just his trainer.
He's also vertically challenged when jumping. If you go back and you watch, I think, and here's, it's been a while, it's been a little bit, but if you go back and I think watch Rocky 3 and Rocky 4, when Duke jumps over the ropes to get in, he's in such a hurry in between rounds, he like falls and trips over the ropes and lands on his face. But and when he's, and one of my favorite lines, he's telling the ref in Rocky 4, "This is supposed to be an exhibition," and the spit is flying everywhere. Oh, it's so phenomenal. It's so phenomenal. When I got to tell you this quick story. I was doing a gig in Cherry Hill one time, so I'm all dressed up as Rocky, and I'm walking around, and Jerry Cooney's there. I'm talking to him. Buster Douglas is there. Some of the Eagles. One of the guys from Starsky and Hutch. Laverne and Shirley were there. Like, it was, there was a lot of stars from the 70s. And here's Duke off to the side. And, in back of him was Martin Cove and Johnny Lawrence, the bad guy from The Karate Kid.
Oh, yeah.
Well, anyways, so I come walking down the aisle, and Duke sees me, and he goes, "Oh, my God, Sly, what are you doing here?" And the closer I got, his pupils were dilated, and he smelled like weed. And he goes, "Oh, my God." He goes, "Man, I thought you were Stallone." So we started talking, right? And then I had to go back to work. So I came to see him at the end of the day. And I got my hat and my coat off. I'm just standing there with him. Uh-huh. And I said, "Hey, I got these gloves." I said, "We're just signed a throw the damn towel." So at this point, he was so wrecked. He's writing "throw the damn towel," and he looks at me and he goes, "How do you spell damn?" I thought, "Any way you want, my friend, it's fine." And so it was really great. I've got this great picture of me and him doing the Rocky fist under the chin. You know, it was just a great time.
That's awesome. Tony Barber gets blazed.
Oh, he was out of his mind, man. But a great guy. Yeah. Really nice guy.
It was kind of recent, though, that he died, right?
Yeah, he actually was going to be in Creed, but his health had deteriorated. Mm-hmm. The scene where we get, I guess, Duke Jr., you know, like kind of berating Adonis not to fight or whatever, that was supposed to be Duke, but his health was not good.
Yeah. That's a shame. Yeah. Big loss for the Rocky community.
Oh, my God. Big loss. Rest in peace, Tony Burton. Rest in peace.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You're here. All right. So Juergens loves this idea.
He says it's very American.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And he shakes his fist in like a only the way they did in the 1970s.
There's that very last frame of the minute where you have Juergens. You see him from behind. So you got the back of his head. He's got his fist out. Apollo's right up in his face with a determined look on his face, and there's a Duke in the background smiling away, and you realize that this is a great idea all around.
Yeah, I love the way the frame is. The shot is framed.
Of course, if you're watching the movie, you're not even going to notice this second. But
all right. Yeah.
And that's how it ends.
But Apollo, before the last thing Apollo says is no, Jurgens. He's going to add to it. Politely disagrees that it's not very American, and we're going to have to find out tomorrow what he thinks about it.
Well, before we tune in next week to find out what he says about this, do you guys know the story on The Office here that they're in?
It's Winkler's office?
Yeah, it's Winkler's office, but two things. It's the same office that they use when they do the fight press conference coming up, and the backdrop, when you look out the window and you see the Philadelphia backdrop,
mm-hmm.
That's actually a backdrop of New York City that they used, that they put in front of the office. And if you watch very carefully, you can see it shimmer. The people holding it taut didn't hold it tight mm-hmm. enough. You can actually see it shimmer if you're watching closely. But that usually only happens after you see the movie 600-700 times, like me.
So. Yeah, because this office was on the MGM lot. In
true.
LA, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, so they had to wheel in the backdrop.
Exactly.
Why don't you let us know what your history with the movie is, like when you first saw it and like your feelings about it.
So I was 8 years old in 1976. I never saw it in the big theater at that point. So I was 11 years old in 1979. It premiered on TV for the first time. And I had some serious issues in the schoolyard with schoolyard bullies. A lot of kids have that, but it really affected me in a unique way. The way I thought to handle it was the year before, when I was 10, my parents bought me a Halloween costume. It was a Superman Halloween costume. So what I used to do to protect myself, I would wear the Superman costume underneath my school clothes, and my shirt would get bunched up with the cape, right? So I'd go up beyond the schoolyard, and the schoolyard bully would literally rip my shirt, and the cape would come out, and as Rocky would say, thereby exposing himself to the, public. You know how kids are. Kids are very mm-hmm. cruel. So they would start taunting me about my Superman costume. So I came home, and my mother's like, maybe you don't wear the costume, whatever. My father was a little worried about it. So a year goes by, Rocky comes out, it's this big success, and I'm still having problems. And he goes, come on, let's watch this movie. Maybe you might find something interesting about it. Now, I come from a middle-class home. My parents were always there for us. We always had a vacation. Bills were always paid. What in the world would draw me to a 30-year-old leg breaker for the Philly mob who was a third-rate fighter who smoked? So, like, yeah, sure, Dad. So we're sitting there on a Sunday night, and the announcer says, and now Rocky. And, of course, those big white letters scroll mm-hmm. across the screen, and you hear fanfare for Rocky, Bill Conti's unbelievable music, and I literally felt my DNA begin to change. I could imagine these little cleft notes, these musical cleft notes coursing through my veins, and I was speechless and slack-jawed through the whole movie. Nothing, and I'm telling you, nothing moved me like this before. I seriously felt this was the purest form of inspiration I had ever heard at my age of 11 years old. The night before I went to bed, after the movie, I took one of those grease pencils that you would write on the tin foil on the freezer. My mother would write on what the food was. And I wrote on the back of my gray sweatshirt, Italian Stallion. And I wore it to school the next day. But the problem was I was an idiot and I couldn't spell. So I spelt Italian Stallion wrong. So I was just more of a bullseye for the students to pick on me even worse. And it just grew from that. When I was 13, the beatings continued. My grandfather heard about it. Oh, my God, it was brutal.
Oh, my God.
My grandfather heard about this, and he knew my love for dressing up like movie characters. So he calls me up to his house one night, and he gives me He says, "Mikey, I have something that may help you." And he reaches up to a shelf and he pulls out a hat box, and it's his old black fedora that he gave me as a young, that he wore as a young man. He's now giving to me. And then he hands me his old black leather jacket. So I put it on. I look in the mirror and I'm like, "Oh my God, Grandpa, I'm Rocky." And he goes, "Yeah." He goes, "You know what? You got a look here. You kind of look like Rocky." He goes, "But you got to learn how to throw a punch." He goes, "These people are all, they're never going to leave you alone. You're always going to be running." So I didn't want to hear that because I didn't want to get hit. I didn't want to hit anybody. At that time, I was not like an alpha male type. I still really am not like an alpha male. So I'm more like a talker guy, as you could tell. So anyways, yeah, you didn't notice, ain't exactly, exactly. My wife is always feeding me shuddy stew, you know? But anyways, that's the long and the short of it. That's how I fell in love with the character of Rocky, and I tried out for high school sports. I never did very well. I was always like the last one on the bench. But the thing was, Rocky was always on the bench with me. When I was sitting there alone, he was the one that kept me company, and I love this character. It's never been about the money. It's never been about the muscles or anything. It's always been about just trying. Even if you fail, try. So, you know, there you go.
Well, it's kind of like what's that when there's like a like divine cause for us to find you, because I was just on Twitter looking through Rocky pages and stuff, and I came across you. It seems like the Rocky community is pretty expansive.
Yes.
Like there's a lot of people that devote, I mean, there's a bunch of other podcasts out there. As well as people that love and found inspiration from the movie.
Oh my God! Oh, you're totally right. There are people. There's something I get on my job that I normally would not ever be able to have. I'll get a call from I'll get an email from a mother in Canada, and she'll say, "Our family's coming down to Philly in 2 days, and my son's a big Rocky fan. He's 11 years old, and he wants us to take the tour." I would have already been working 2 tours a day for about 18 days straight. So I take a day off and I tell, I say, no, I'm not going to be in Philly on this day. So she sends me another email and she says, "You know, Mr. Kunda, I apologize for pushing the issue, but here's the thing. My son just went through the rarest form of cancer an 11-year-old can have, and he went through 2 rounds of chemo. And when he went through chemo, he would watch Rocky on a DVD player, Rocky 1 and Rocky 2. An 11-year-old in 2016 or 2015 fell in love with the character of Rocky when there's so many other distractions they could have. And the mother said, "Well, you know, anywhere you want to go, when you beat cancer, I'll take you anywhere. You want to go to Paris, you want to go to Florida, anywhere you want to go." And the kid said, "Mom, I want to go to Philadelphia. I want to go to Rocky. I want to see where Rocky ran." So she Googled Rocky Tours. I came up. Now, how the hell are you going to say no to cancer kid?
Oh, yeah, you can't.
Ooh, that's bad karma, pal. That is bad karma. So you go down, and I really put a big show on for this kid. I really – the hat, the coat, the bruised eye, the cut-off gloves, the sweatshirt, everything. And so, okay, we go through the tour. He sits up front. This kid – I think his name was John. This kid had – he had more cojones than any adult male I ever met. I mean, this kid is – he was tough. So at the end – we're all running up the steps. Of course, he's leading the way, and he's we're on about the 5th step from the top, and he's up there jumping around with his arms up. And I look over my shoulder, and his parents are crying, and I start to cry. But this kid, he didn't know he should have been dead. All he knows is he's in Rocky Land, and he's jumping around on the Rocky steps. And, you know, 6 months ago, he just saw this in a movie while he was getting chemo for his cancer. And it was the most beautiful experience, one of the most beautiful experiences I've had. And you get to see this, and it renews my faith in at a time when we're in very difficult surroundings in this country right now. So that's one of the big pluses I get from my tours.
Yeah,
that's a great story,
right? I mean, there's many ways you can get inspiration from Rocky, and you just told us the most heartwarming one possible.
It's about not giving up, fighting, all fits in.
Yeah.
Yeah, Jason, exactly, right? I mean, here's a little kid who has no idea he's probably 4 months away from dying. He beats the odds. He literally goes the distance with chemo, knocks out cancer, and the kid, who knows where he's going to go in life? Who knows how Rocky will continue to influence him? And I only hope that he keeps updating me on how he's doing in life, because nothing humbles me more than when I hear these stories.
Maybe we can get him on the show one day.
Yeah, seriously. Sorry. Would that be something?
I got some in my eye. You'll have to excuse me. All right. Where on the worldwide webs can our people find you?
All right. So I'm on Twitter. I'm on Facebook. You can Google my website, the Yo Philly Rocky Film Tour. There's a lot of pages. You can go through them. You can see videos and pictures of me. My first book, Cue the Rocky Music, which is all about practice and timing. It's sort of an abbreviated version of my life and how I became an acquaintance to Sylvester Stallone, my time on the set of Rocky Balboa and Creed, talking with all the major players, my friendship with Burt Young, how that all came to be, and the time I boxed Apollo Creed for about 45 seconds in front of 500 people in Philadelphia, which is a great story. Really? Yeah. So check it out. It's all there.
Excellent. All right. As for us, you can find us on Twitter at Rocky Minute. You can find us on Facebook. Our page is Rocky Minute. And we have a listeners group called Mighty Mix. That's M-I-C-K-S, like the gym. You can find us along with a bunch of other Minute by Minute podcasts and other podcasts on duelinggenre.com. And forget anything?
Nope.
Our email is rockyminute@gmail.com. We do have an email.
We get an email.
And if you are so inclined, why don't you head over to iTunes and give us a review, hopefully a good one. We appreciate everything that all the kind words that we're getting from our listeners. Mike, do you want to come back tomorrow and join us again?
Listen, I would love to come back and talk more about Jergens, because that's the way I see it. It's very American. No Jergens. It's very smart.
What a great way to end. All right, we'll see you all tomorrow on the next Rocky Minute.